It's Monday night, 6:30 through to 8 o'clock, and it's, of course, the Tilton Talk Show, mate. It's Tilton Talk Show. Here we go. Football to talk about this weekend, to be honest with you, apart from a very boring, drab England game, which I didn't watch, but my children did, and they said it was absolutely awful. However, good news. We have some good news. The building work is back underway. The refurbishment is back underway. Can't wait. Can't wait to see St Andrews absolutely full and rocking. Okay, introducing you to the team tonight. The one I think is Mr Chris Brown.
Good evening.
And of course, this show is sponsored by Small Affordable Cars of Tamworth.
Don't forget
them people. Must forget them people. The lovely Claire Giblin.
Good evening.
The inevitable savant of all savants in the whole wide world, Paul Hipkiss.
Evening.
And then we're going to Watto, Chairman of the Board.
Good evening, everybody.
And, what's his name? Mr. Robe. Oh, he's here. Crikey. My God.
Good evening.
And we're all the way from Texas, United States of America, Mark Meredith.
Evening, all.
Brilliant.
And we've got,
Brilliant Australian accent.
Was, yeah.
Tremendous. Then I'll introduce Craig Courtney.
Good evening, all.
And special guest tonight, Dave Taylor. Hello, Dave.
Hi, Agent. You're right.
Yeah. Dave, tell us about yourself, what you do, et cetera.
So, yeah, reached out to Craig early today, a bit late in the day, just thought it'd be a good idea to pop on, keeping regular contact with Craig. He's asked me to help support you guys in raising some funds for the QE. I think most of us being Brummies have some connection to the QE. Craig explained his reasons for that. I personally had my brother-in-law sort of looked after in the QE, so, you know, I was more than happy to support. So I'll be doing something next week to help raise some funds under your banner to get some much-needed money to support the activities at the QE. But also, something else that's happening now, I'm a big supporter of the Justice for the 21 campaign. I've been for a number of years. Done a number of fundraising events, and yesterday we had the latest charity walk start from Brum, and we've got two guys, Ian Williams and Glenn Randall, who are walking from Birmingham to Belfast, walk up to Liverpool. They'll be there by Friday evening and then jump on a plane out to Belfast. They'll be greeted by a number of people in Belfast and then walk into the city centre. All to raise funds to support the campaign for the families. Being Brummies, most of us know the story of Justice for the 21. Looking at today's sort of attendees, most of us will remember 1974 and the activities, and those of us of a certain age either knew somebody that was directly affected or knew someone who was part of a family that was affected by it. The bare facts are 49 years on, you know, those families still have had no justice. Our cities have no justice, and that's something that quite a few of us are still fighting to try and achieve. The two guys that are actually walking to Belfast aren't actually Brummies. Ian's from Preston, and for his sins is a dirty Leeds fan. But I don't hold back too much against him. And then Big Glenn is from London, and he's a Spurs fan. Both of them, I consider brothers. Glenn actually came over to France when I had my little incident last year and come and spent a few days with me. We're that close. I walked the first 10 miles with them yesterday. A week ago, I wouldn't have been capable of doing that, but thankfully during the week, I felt much better, and for me, it was a personal achievement. It's by far the furthest I've walked since last year. Why it's important that they're aiming to raise £5,000 towards the legal costs that the families are hit with constantly. We're off to a reasonable start. There's about 600 £700 in the kitty. Last time when they did a similar walk, the walk from Birmingham to London, they raised over £6,000 for the family, all the money going directly to the cause. Independent sponsors support their travel costs and accommodation costs. So I just wanted tonight to sort of take 5 minutes out of your evening and everybody else who's listening to just try and raise awareness, A, for the cause, the campaign for Justice for the 21. If you don't know the story, please Google it and have a look. It still amazes me that you come across families that don't understand what happened in November 1974. And if you can, I won't repeat the donation link on here because it's quite a lengthy one. But if it's okay with you guys, I'll post it up on the page later, if that's okay.
Yeah, of course it is.
Obviously, we can raise some much-needed funds. And just, find them on Facebook under Justice for the 21 and just keep in touch with them, send them a message, just keep them jollying along. I've been harassing them most of the day. Absolutely gutted I can't be with them. And unfortunately, I can't get up to Belfast or Liverpool to get to Belfast with them. But there's plenty of people that will be there to support them. And we gave them a good old Brummy send-off on Saturday. The reason I didn't see the match on Saturday, we were celebrating these two guys being in our fine city and giving them a good Brummy send-off in town. So thankfully, they weren't too bad. They could get up Sunday morning and start the walk. So, but yeah, just cheer them along. If you can, please donate and support these guys. As I say, they're not Brummies. They're from other parts of the country. There's lots of people around the country, again, through the football family. It's always the football family that reach out and look to do these special things to help whatever causes we aim to support. So if anyone wishes to know any more about it, you can contact me direct. I will post a link up. But please, whatever if you can, spare whatever. It's difficult times, I know, for everyone, but, it doesn't have to be a big donation. We're a big city. I constantly get upset that it has to take two people from out of our city to go and do the walk to raise awareness. But thankfully, we've got good people that do that. Let's show these guys how much we think of them by raising some funds for them and their families.
Superb. One of the best 7 minutes. One of the best 7 minutes the talk show's had in a very, very long time. Absolutely good brilliant. Stuff. Right. What's the affinity with the Bear and the Ragged Staff, your Warwickshire emblem there on your hat?
Well, I'm a massive Warwickshire supporter. During the summer, I tend to watch the cricket.
That's all right. I'm a Warwick boy myself, you see.
Yeah. Brummy born and bred. And when I was born, we were still Warwickshire. So, a lot of people shy away from it because they only see the political side of it. What they don't see is that there's people from all walks that were affected. My wife, if anyone's met my wife, she's Irish, a family from Galway. She's actually got family members that I've met that were on the other side of the fence. And those of us that know most of the facts around it, it's not really an Irish issue. But we're not here to go into that. But she was born in 1974, and her dad died 2 weeks before she was born. So her mum brought her up. She can remember walking down the road and seeing her mum being spat at as a child because she was Irish. That's what the Irish community had to go through because of this act. And it pales into significance what the families that were directly affected by it, but it was all walks. We've tried for a long time to get the club to actually do something. There's two of the 21 were devout Blues fans, season ticket holders, and we've tried to get things done by the club to recognise them. We think we've now got the okay for two plaques to be done, to be put on the wall, the walls in their memory, which would be a nice touch. And each year we try and bring, they've got actual shadows of each of the victims. We try and bring those along. But all I would say, if you don't really understand what happened, look into it. It affected our city in a massive way, those of us that lived through it and still does.
Yeah. But on the night, I mean, I was born till 76, but my dad was actually in town that night. My dad and my uncle and their friends were actually in town, and they heard it all go off.
Yeah.
And they said they said somebody was running around saying, you know, get on the bus, get back to Harbour or whatever. Because they thought it was a fire from a gasworks or something. They didn't realise, you know, the full extent of what happened.
You don't when these things first happen, do you?
Well, no, I mean, he says he remembers running to a payphone and quickly phoning my mum. She said, look, something's gone on in town. I'm on the bus home, like, and like my uncle and their mates, they all went back home. But, my dad even now says it was just horrific. It was just...
I do a lot with... the Hamiltons a big in running this. Julie Hamilton.
Yeah.
She lost her older sister, Maxine. On Facebook, she uses Maxine Hamilton as a name. Maxine was 18. She was going around to hand invites out for a housewarming party, and she actually stood right next to the bombs that went off. Mm-hmm. Her family's never recovered from that. Brian, the brother who dropped her off in town, has never forgiven himself. Margaret, the mom, I was with Margaret again yesterday. You know, he's still devastated by it. 49 years on, I've lost a son. I got three fantastic lads. I lost a son. And it never leaves you. But to actually lose someone who you'd spent 18 years of your life nurturing and in such a horrific way, and 49 years later, still not have justice, I really don't know how that.
Okay. It's not just justice, is it? It's answers.
Yeah. Well, answers are justice, aren't they, Nick? You know, it's...
Yeah, I get that, yeah.
Yeah, there's lots of pieces to the story. As always, without the truth, people put things together and piece something, and two and two comes to something more than four or less than four.
My mum in 2005, the London bombings, my mum was on the tube, literally the one 5 minutes before the one that blew up. So if she'd have been 5 minutes later, you know, so you just, it just shakes you, doesn't it? You know,
scary. Everything's an if in life, though, isn't it?
Definitely.
While we're on the subject of terrorism and, you know, obviously 9/11, 22 years ago today, and I just want to send my love and thoughts out to, and I'm sure for everyone here as well.
Absolutely.
You know, our friends over in New York and our wonderful owners in America, you know, just want to send out our thoughts to them as well on the anniversary of the worst day by far in America's history.
Where was you that day, Paul?
I was at work. I was working at Betterware as a team leader. I'd just come back off my lunch break, actually. It was like 10 to 2, quarter to 2
in the afternoon.
Yeah, because they're 5 hours behind, aren't they? I mean, I was only there in February this year, obviously, as Mark Meredith, you know. It was very emotional being there then, and you know, today obviously they're paying some great tributes down where we were, and obviously I'm educating my daughter on it all as well. She obviously was long before her, but she's obviously been educated on it as well now with obviously our visit back in February. But we might as well go around actually. What's everyone's 9/11 stories? Where were we all?
There you go. That's exactly what I was going to say next.
I was in those two buildings. Couple of months before it happened, it was my 50th birthday, and the kids had treated me to a week in New York. And me and the missus had a deal. We were going shopping, and there's a place called Century 21 outside the Twin Towers, and it's still there. Everything around the Twin Towers is still there. It's only the Twin Towers that got knocked down. And we have this deal. We go shopping, and after 20 minutes, if she's bought nothing, we'd part company and meet up an hour later. And then she still hasn't. Anyway, I wandered across to the Twin Towers, and I went up to the top. And that morning, it was about 9:30, and there were hundreds of New York kids, you know, all about 8, 9, 10. And kids of 8, 9, 10 are noisy. New York kids are absolutely noisy. It's a din. You can't hear yourself think with these kids. Anyway, I got away from them by going right up to the top in the cafe, and I took a picture of the, wherever Bridget is.
Brooklyn. Brooklyn Bridge.
Brooklyn Bridge, you're correct. And then I went down again, and I got to the wrong floor, because there's two lifts. One where you go straight to the top, and obviously the lifts that people would go to work there. And I got lost, and I couldn't get out the building. Right, that was on a perfectly sunny day in early June, and I was in right panic. Anyway, that was it. And then I always remember going down in the lift on my own with this chap, the lift operator, and we had a chat. You know, oh, you're from England, you know, all that stuff. And this lift was just like a big metal box on a string, and it went down, and I said, thank you very much. And I thought about that kid. He could well have been in that lift that morning when that box was on fire with, you know, airplane fuel, etc. He would have been like in an oven, and he would have been burnt to a crisp, like, you know, like that. Now, hopefully he wasn't working that day, who knows, but it was so horrific. I haven't got it anymore. I bought a suit that day. I went across to this place, and I bought a suit, I bought a tie with the Empire State Building on it. And I always wanted a flashy American suit. And I bought that day, and I kept it till quite recently. It just didn't fit me anymore. It was much too big. but it was the thought of what those people were suffering. You know, I had a lot, apart from these squealing kids who annoyed me, you know, I could live with that again now. If you could turn the clock back, I'd have that again any time, rather than see what happened. It was horrific. Just the thoughts of, you know, where I'd been, and those places didn't exist anymore. They'd just been wiped out.
What about you?
I was actually on a plane on the way to Sweden to work. And I landed. I picked up a hire car to go from Gothenburg up to Trollhättan. I couldn't get a radio station with any decent music on it. It was just all low-key music, right? And I thought, oh, the King of Sweden must have dropped dead or something. And I gets to work, and the gaffer says to me, because streaming video was new then, yeah? And I was the only one in our team to have a live link to Sky News. And basically, the gaffer says to me, he says, oh, a biplane has just crashed into the Twin Towers in America. I says, all right, I'll get it on my news feed, da, 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 da. And my news feed flashed up just as, well, about 35 seconds before that second plane went into the second tower. And I said to my gaffer, I says, if this is going to be World War III, I'm going home. And if I'm going to die, I want to die with my children. And that was it. But we couldn't go anywhere. We were so restricted, and we got bussed by the ministry, the Swedish Ministry of Defence, all the way up to Stockholm to come back. Mm-hmm. That's my story. There you go, Chris Brown.
Craig, do you remember anything about it?
Well, I was 10 at the time, so I had just started U6, and I remember walking home from school. And we put the TV on, and that was all that we saw. So we literally saw everything. And it was, I'll never forget, it's the first time I think, really, I remember something being on every channel. And every channel you went on was the same story. And I thought, oh, we put a film on. I'm thinking, oh, my brother's got his war film on or something. And then it just, then all of a sudden it hit you that it was actually something in real life, and I don't think you will ever forget. There's certain times in life where you go, that's where I was at that moment, that's how old I am. And you know, it's when everything just kept accumulating, so it was one thing and then now going somewhere else and then now somewhere else, and I think that was the start of obviously everything else that happened. But I don't think you ever forget things like that.
Moments
like that, no, they're sticking in your memory forever.
Yeah, what about you, Mark Meredith? Would you, obviously, I guess this was when you were still in the UK, was it?
Yeah, I was back at home with Mum and Dad. And again, the same as Claire, just watching it on the TV and obviously not knowing much about it then. But obviously, as the years have gone by and moving here, it's got bigger and bigger, and the tributes are obviously a lot more. So certainly the last 10 years that I've been in the States, it's been, I've learned a lot more about it. Yeah. Still haven't visited. I still haven't been to visit the the memorial and stuff, and I hopefully soon I will. But yeah, the day of it, it was just sitting at home with my mom and dad, and just not really understanding what was going on at the time. You know, just watching it on the news and just being pretty much shocked at it being so much, you know, live footage of these planes just smashing into it. So.
Yeah, yeah. I just remember back in February walking to those, you know, the waterfalls where they've got everyone's names around, and it just sends, like, you know, shivers down your spine. And then they've got this sphere. Of, there was a sphere that was in between the towers. Alan, you might remember that. There was like a sphere in between the two towers, and that's all that's all battered and bruised now. But they have left that on, like, on top of the steps on, like, the memorial.
I have been back to the site. When it was still a pile of rubble, saw the cross that they'd made out of twisted metal. And thinking back to these noisy kids and the way it was that morning, going to it 5 or 6 years later, I suppose, I travelled down from Boston just to go there. And there's notices everywhere, please respect, because you know what it's like in America. If there's an excuse to sell people stuff, you know, there's no souvenir sellers. It's you go there and it's total silence in the middle of, you know, the noisiest place on earth, probably. Yeah. There's this silence. They've rebuilt it now. And I remember thinking, what a difference. And, you know, what a bloody big hole. You know, it's a massive hole. You could have put St. Andrews in it. You know, the hole that had been made. But I'm glad I went back. It took me a long time before I did, but I'm glad I went back. And I'd like to go again and see what's there now.
I was gonna, sorry to jump in, but I went first time 2 years after it happened. 2003 I first went to Ground Zero, and it's like the big craters, and you couldn't go anywhere near it, it's just like orange, like plastic fences, you couldn't get anywhere near it. And I remember some guys, they were like selling souvenir guy, and it just seemed so wrong. But then we went back 5 years ago, 2018, and see how it all changed. Like say, Paul, that area, it's so eerie and silent by that fountain. I knew it'd be sad, but you feel yourself well enough because it's so emotional.
Mark, it was very much the same when I went to Auschwitz.
We stood
in a gas chamber, and you looked up at the hole in where they put the Zyklon V. Nobody would talk. Nobody.
No.
Where was you, Dave?
I've worked for many American companies. I worked for Dana Corporation then, and I was actually in my boardroom just to go on to. Conference call with the guys in Detroit, and literally as we joined up, someone came into the office in Detroit and says, put the news on straight away. So we put our telly on there and spent the next, can't even tell you how many hours, just on this conference call, then watching it happen in America on the TV, and us in Birmingham watching it on the TV, and just been cold because you knew people that sort of worked in New York, and you know, didn't know anyone who directly worked in the towers, but knew people that frequented them quite often. Thankfully, as far as I know, no one I know was lost in it, but it just left such a chilling feeling. And obviously being an American business, you know, it just, there's weeks of sort of different things, different events, different memorials. I can remember we had, I can't remember how many weeks it was after, but there was a thing come around, so we'll have like a minute silence of respect for those that were lost. And every day in the plant was told to respect it. Obviously, being in Birmingham, we had some people that didn't feel that their religious beliefs would allow them to do that. So it caused quite a quite a stir in the factory. We had quite a lot of bad feeling for a number of months because of it. I've actually been to New York probably a dozen times from before and asked, but I've never actually visited New York. I've only ever been in and out of the airport and I've felt a few times like I'd find time to sort of go and visit it. But it's like it's one of those that, you know, you just feel cold now and tingling just thinking about it. And yeah, you know, it's one of those things like Nick said, I've done Auschwitz and that is just spine chilling and even, you know, I'm an enthusiast about the war. I read a lot about the war, so I actually thought, well, I'm prepared for it. I understand what went on and but when you're there, it's just incredible. And I think it's the size and the magnitude of it, you know, that just blows you away. And I think it would be the same with the towers.
Yeah. You know, the getting a bit restless, but it is both with a weekly appearance on the
TV talk. Yeah. It is one of those things that you never, you know, just listening to you guys, I was back in that boardroom, you know, on the call with them. And it's just, crazy.
Yeah, everyone where I worked at the time, everyone was in the conference room watching it on the TV, and I was like, "Who's manning the phones there? Like, you know, what's going on?"
Yeah, and then it was
I've got in the conference room, and then you know, we all saw the second plane live. It was just horrendous, horrible.
We saw the whole thing unfurl because literally it was breaking as so we went on the call, and time just stood still. Time stood still for a while. And I think Claire says there was different things happening and reports of other planes. And there was the thing with the Pentagon and, you know, it just seemed to sort of go on and on. And you didn't, I've done the trip up to Trollhättan a few times from Gothenburg, Nick. And, you know, I was due to go over to the States a few days after.
What a beautiful place.
I missed my trips to Sweden. And then into Europe. The week after, and everything just got canned. You know, you just told you're not traveling. I mean, I think it was months after before we were allowed to travel anywhere, and it was because you were part of an American company as well. You were seen as a. You know, I'm sure anyone that worked for American companies, it was the same. If you was sort of going around and used to being a traveller, you were a soft target. So you were told to, you know, all American companies just stop traveling. So.
Crazy, crazy, crazy. But, you know, for me, and if you've not been to Auschwitz and you've got an inclination, please do it. Please, I beg you. I implore you. Please, please do it. And for me, the two things I'll remember, well, no, I'll remember all of it. I promise you I really will. But the ones that stick out was the gates at Auschwitz. I've seen them on the telly on films, but now here they are right in front of me. And you put your hand on that cold metal and you think about what went on inside, but you have no clue, really. I know Birkenau, just up the road, 10 times the size of Auschwitz.
Yeah, you need to go when it's cold as well, because you realise actually how horrendous it was.
Yeah, I went there in the winter. Dave, can I? You mentioned the effect that 9/11 had on the different communities you were working with. I remember at the time, life. We live in a multiracial city, or we did then, and to be honest, things were okay. You know, there might have been all sorts of different arguments, but my Asian friend said life changed for him. He'd be a young man in his 20s then. Life changed for him that day because nobody ever looked at him the same again.
Yeah.
He felt it.
Yeah, I was born in 64, right next to the Blues Ground, Templefield Street. He got moved out, batted around Centre Brun. First of all, it was, you know, you had a lot of Irish come in. There was lots of issues with the Irish at first. Then you had the Caribbean influence come in. Then you had the Asian influence come on. And I love my city and I love my people, but that's not, it's all people. I absolutely adore the fact that, you know, I've been lucky to travel the world with work, but I experienced the world in my own city.
Yeah, absolutely.
What makes us blues fans is, you know, we're Irish, we're Caribbean, we're Asian.
Absolutely.
We're all the same. We stand behind one love, and that's the love of our club and our city. It doesn't matter. Yeah. We always say blues fans don't see colour. Some people take offence to that, but we don't. We just say,
well, I've got a T-shirt which says on it, Dave, right? I see the person. It's got a Birmingham City sign, round like yours, and on where that writing is on behind you, I see the person, not the colour.
Yeah.
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 Chris and Craig, went to on 9/11?
I worked for British Gas, so I was actually, I'd not long got into the office. And I always remember we was in this brand spanking new office, and
you must have been on half a day. Must have been on half a day.
I used to work at evenings, so it was, I was getting in. But it was it was one that I can always remember, just picking up the phone and just picking up with the missus and just, you know, have you seen or what's happening and stuff. And all the TV screens within the office had changed from where they were displaying, you know, what our results were looking like, to actually showing what was happening. And you know, we were linked to companies out in the States, so it was, you do immediately think of those people that are out there and you know, what's coming next. But I think the same as everybody else, it was apprehension afterwards. What does this mean? You know, it was that fear of the unknown of what had happened. And I don't think, you know, and honestly, for anyone, it was until a few days afterwards that things really hit home. And you know, Dave, you've spoken at the beginning around the Justice for the 21 and the support that people have put forwards, but I know it's been adversely reported as well around things, and I think it's, you know, as a gent that sits next to me in the Tilton, and, you know, despite everything that he's up against, he still does absolutely everything to raise funds and get the word out around what's happening. So, you know, for those listeners that may have joined after the, you know, you went through the details at the beginning, what else can people do to help support the Justice for 21? And, you know, whether it be just making people aware, whether it be pointing people to websites or socials, and also, you know, if people want to give at a later stage, but, you know, where do we go? What's the best
just before you go to that, David, you talked briefly about the football family as well, and I mean, justice for the 21, that really is, that is nationwide, isn't it? With clubs and that, a lot of clubs pitch in with the campaign, don't they?
Absolutely. I mean, I did. Again, Justice for the 21. We say it's not about your team, it's about the city and the people, which is our people, you know, and our city. But what we did, the original T-shirts, you might, people wear the black and white ones, but then we came up with the idea of having blue and white ones, them other colours, you know.
Hey, good man.
I couldn't bring myself to say.
It's West Ham colours, you can say, Dave.
Yeah, West Ham colours. West Ham, I like it. West Ham colours, Albion colours, even, you know, even the yellow and green, which I must say looks really smart, the yellow and green Albion one.
I thought that was Norwich. Sorry, mate.
No, not Norwich. But I did the blue and white ones, and honestly, I was sending them all around, loads to Belfast, loads to Glasgow, even the fella up in Grimsby, loads to Millwall lads, Chelsea lads, everywhere. And you get, you know, messages from everyone. I mean, on Saturday, so we put the word out that Glenn and Ian would be in the city. There were probably about two dozen people turn up. One lad drove up from Southend with his family, because he's a mighty Glens, just to spend the night in the city and see him off. And it's those things that, and it doesn't matter whether it's 24 or 240, it's that. And when if you look at Find Justice for the 21 on Facebook and just look at the messages of support and look at where the people are from, it's all over the country. you know. And like I say, Ian's a Leeds fan. He considers himself, he considers Birmingham his second home. Glenn's a Spurs lad. And he always says, I love him. Honestly, I do love him like a brother and what he's done for me when I was ill. But as soon as you see him, the first thing he tells any Blues fan is, I was in your seats in the 80s when we come and showed you how it's done. And, it, you know, but then days are gone. We all look after each other. And when I go down to Spurs, they really, really look after you. It's people from all walks of life. Find them on Facebook. I'll put the links up on the Tilton Talk Show to not only the donation page, but also a few pages where people can find out a bit more. But if there's three things I'd ask, do a bit of research into if you don't understand it. If you can, spare the odd dollar and donate for these lads who are giving their time and trust me, a lot of blood and sweat to get up to Belfast. The third thing is we have a memorial every year on the anniversary. We have a service in St. Philip's, and then we walk to the Justice for the 21 memorial that's just beyond, still call it New Street Station, but Grand Central, I think they're calling there between Grand Central. We've been to that, and some of it is the police set up in a way where it's not really cordoned off. We've been there, and I personally, I had a young lad come at me with a skateboard because he took offence to the fact that we were blocking his way so he could skateboard through the city. We stopped him and educated him, and he was mortified after, you know. But that's turn up, show these families that they're not forgotten. With a city of a million people, and if there's 100 people at these memorials, that's as much as we get.
Yeah. Show sorry, those families you just they're said, not you forgotten. Just said that lad was going through the city centre on a skateboard, not got a care in the world, not worried about anybody else. You stopped him, you educated him. He was mortified.
Yeah, he was.
That is the lesson for every single person.
He stood for the rest of the event.
Well done to the lad, not being funny.
Yeah, no, you know, it would
well
have
done
been
to you guys for educating him, but well done to the lad for saying, wow, this is a serious course. I'm stopping what I'm doing. Take back what I might have said or not said or whatever, and then just, you know, gone with it.
Can I just say that? Can I just say, hang on, Paul. Hang on.
You let people know the dates that this happened.
Yeah.
Paul, I can hardly hear you. I don't know what you're.
Hang on, I was just going to say.
I've got it tattooed on the arm.
November 1974.
Are we doing anything at home and away games for it? Are we doing anything like away or doing any collecting at the ground?
We have done. We did it before the Leeds game, I think it was. We did a collection. I think they raised about £600. We do it at the other place, at the Albion and at Blues, at least once a season, if not a couple of times. I may well try and I will speak to Tony and see if we can do something on the coaches on Saturday. You know, we very often throw the buckets around for anything, if we lose anyone or anything in particular, see if we can do something. But, you know, we says today there's 4,500 people on the Justice for the 21 Facebook page. All we need is everyone to donate £1.
Mm-hmm.
For people to put 20 quid in, 50 quid, 100 quid. Mm-hmm. Just everyone throw £1 in.
That's true. Can I just quickly say, because I'm trying to get this in. I mean, we have had Julian and Brian in this very studio a few years ago. For those who don't know the story, if you search for on SRB Media, there's an extensive interview with them both, and some of the stories will shock you. They really will.
We talk about the young lad on the skateboard that I spoke about. One of the guys that died is a young guy was just walking past when the bomb went off. Just walking past through town, not a care in the world. I think he was off to meet his mate with his girlfriend. Can't remember now. You hear so many, you know, what ifs around each and every one of them. Yeah. You know, there was a couple meeting and he was going to propose to her, and, you know, and they were both killed. There was a guy that got killed. His wife was 8 months pregnant. She gave birth a few weeks after, you know, growing up. And, you know, as I said, my own wife, Trish, never knew her daddy died before she was born. You know, I know what that can do for someone. Julie herself, Brian, Margaret, never forgotten. You don't. How can you forget losing someone in those circumstances? It's difficult enough. You never forget if it's someone close, but under those circumstances. And then the British government don't even speak to the families. The Irish government gave them a state reception. Yeah. In Dublin. They were treated like royalty when they went to Dublin. People have stopped me, members of my own family, very close friends of Trish, have stopped me and said, why do you hate the Irish so much? And I said, what are you on about? Well, you fight for this campaign, Justice for the 21, it's anti-Irish. I said, it's absolutely not anti-Irish. I'm married to an Irish woman. My children are a quarter Irish. It's nothing to do with anti-Irish. If anything, the Irish people are supportive. Absolutely. It's about injustice. It's our city. It's 21. And it's not just the 21 lives. 184 were injured. Most of them.
And of course, David,
life-changing injuries. They've had to live with that as well for the rest of their lives.
Another thing we've really got to think about is those guys that were incarcerated for a very long time. Mm. Justice for them as well.
Justice means justice. It's not, you know, when the guys get to Belfast, the lay in the reef in the name of justice for the 21, but the lay in the reef in the memory of everybody lost during the Troubles.
There's
no distinguishing of religion, of what, you know, nationality or anything. It's like when, you know, I have the same with Remembrance Day. I do a lot for Remembrance Day. And you get it all. It's this, that, and the other. It's about all dead from all wars and remembering those people that sacrificed.
You know what, David? You're absolutely right, and I know that the rest of the team all know this, but I'm just going to turn my iPad around. All right. That is a memorial wall to my other half's son who was killed in Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm. I just want to say, Dave, I think for everything that you've been through as well, I want to just congratulate you for the walk yesterday and just congratulate you for keeping going and doing all this for the justice for the 21. I just think that I think you're amazing, to be honest. So I just want to say
fair play. I don't have the same view myself, but I appreciate your words. I've spin that around, and I don't ever... And what you guys do, it's fantastic. You give your time every week to do this for our club and our fans, you know. And there's been times, and, you know, me and Chris went through a spell. We didn't quite see eye to eye. And sometimes when you're in the midst of a battle and we were fighting for our club, you don't always see eye to eye. But it doesn't mean that, you know, I learned early in business, there's nothing personal. You stand your corner, you fight your corner.
Yeah.
But I get, you can probably tell without my voice, I take this personally. This hurts me. And I was in no fit state to do any of the walk 5 days ago. I made myself get into a condition where I could. If I can, there's no reason anyone else couldn't. And as much as I love the two guys that are doing the walk, as much as, you know, there's lots of people, and there are lots of people who do stuff in the background for this cause, for our city, for our club. There's not, with 1 million people in this city, and there's not one Brummie walking that route with them. So the very least we can do is show our thanks for what they're doing for our city and our people by donating, by finding out about what happened. And on the anniversary this year, all turn up at St. Philip's. Let's fill Pigeon Park.
Yeah, Pigeon Park.
With people.
Mm.
And show the families that we've not forgotten.
Mm.
We have posted the website for Justice for the 21 onto the message board. And also, Dave, we have had a message board message from Glenn Randall, who has actually said he's doing the walk, and it's a huge well done to you for it as well. And the other thing I've looked up is, you know, closer to that anniversary, what are the games? And I can see that Birmingham are at home. I think it's the Saturday afterwards on the 25th against Sheffield Wednesday. So perhaps, you know, we can work, as we know people do listen from the club, let's work with the club and see what we can do in and around that day as some sort of commemoration of what's happened, and maybe get some more charity raising done outside the ground on that particular day as well.
Yeah, absolutely. A little bit of a different talk show tonight, ladies and gents, because obviously there's been no games. And Dave, he's such an interesting character. Wow. Dave, were you well received in both Northern and Southern Ireland?
Good question.
There's been times when I haven't been. I've travelled through work. I've travelled everywhere. I used to go to Southern Ireland pretty much every other week.
What was your job?
I've always been in manufacturing, first managers in automotive, latter life, or last 18 years in aerospace. So I've generally I started off in commercial roles, went into operations, then have been sort of MDs of groups. So, you know. So you had to travel. Interesting times when I was younger, fitter, and travelling. Southern Ireland. Much better looking. Much better looking. If you've seen my wife, you know at some point in time I must have been better looking because I've got no money and the other things that you're
over there. Definitely punching there, Dave. Definitely punching.
So you'd get stopped now and again because you were suited and booted and people would want to know what this English guy was doing roaming around Southern Ireland. But generally didn't have any issues, few incidents in pubs where, you know, people would take exception. But I had more difficulty in Belfast.
Really?
Yeah, I would only ever, I'd spend 3 or 4 days at a time in Southern Ireland travelling around, but Belfast, I only ever flew in and I flew out the same day. I've never actually stopped in Belfast. And I had a couple of times in my early trip. I did it twice, my first two trips. Landed in City Airport, jumped in a cab, and away you go. And they start chatting to you. You're suited, booted, overcoat on. You know, I've had short hair or no hair since I was about 28. So you look like you might be something other than what you are. And then you get in a cab and they're getting questioned and you notice the rosary beads hanging from the rearview mirror, and you can get a little bit exciting. And the second time I did it, I mentioned it to where I was going and said, look, you just don't jump in cabs around here. We'll pick you up. Let us know when you land and we'll pick you up. Never had any real trouble, but it just, you had to have your wits about you. Yeah. You had to know where you were going. You had to make arrangements for people to meet you and to drop you back. And it was, I've been in and out of airports all around the world. Belfast City Airport, when the troubles were on, was like landing in the middle of a military base.
I mean, Ireland is an absolutely beautiful country. It's beautiful. And I don't get why so close to our own doorstep there's a divide. I don't get it. I know it's religion and politics and all that. But break down the barriers.
I mean, as a general statement, though, like I said, Belfast, it's lovely. We've been a couple of times.
I've only been to Southern Ireland.
Sorry, Nick.
I've only been to Dublin.
Funnily enough, I've never been to Dublin, but Belfast is. I mean, we've been. Obviously, my son's 16, so we went first time when he was about 7 or 8. Cause he's obsessed with Titanic, so he went to the Titanic quarter and all around there. And it's beautiful. It's so interesting and full of character. It's a really nice place.
Yeah. I've never been to Ireland. Just coming on to Blues a minute, though, what do we all think of the rumours last week about, obviously, the Rangers' connection with Eustace and a certain Wayne Rooney being linked with us? I mean,
can I just say, Paul,
I think it covered a bit more pace. I think it covered a bit more pace than to be a silly rumour, to be honest. I mean, would you hear
it? I think it's a very silly rumour. And I think, personally, right, Eustace knows that things are happening at St Andrews. And he's a blue nose himself, right? As for Rooney, seriously, thank you. No. That's my opinion.
Mark Meredith in America, have you heard much over there about this?
No, not really. Just literally just watching Sky Sports News is the only thing that I've heard. But I think it's more of it just being international break and the press that I've been
prepared to do. Absolutely.
Keyboard people, we're looking to do.
Absolutely.
I'd be amazed if Rangers made the same mistake again. Why would they go for it and try Championship manager again? They've had two and they failed.
Yeah.
Why go for a third?
It's funny how the start of a new week, we haven't heard anything, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it was people putting two and two together. And
keyboard warriors.
Yeah.
I don't think it's just keyboard warriors, though, but in all honesty, I mean, they always say there's no smoke without fire. So perhaps at some point in time, there were discussions, but I think the Rangers owner has gone public and said, he chucked his dolly out of the pram a little bit, which is what caused some of the friction. But I just get really, really fed up of listening to some of the drivel that is out there. It's reported, and then all of a sudden everybody's jumping on the bandwagon. Do you know what? As a club, well, we've been through enough. We don't need any more change. We need stability. And the way to build stability...
If we lose 4 or 5 games on the bounce, trust me, he won't have long.
No, he won't have long. No, I agree.
And as for Rooney, though, the only reason why Rooney's been touted for is because he's in America at the moment, so people have gone two or two and gone American owners.
And he knows Brady. I think Gary Cook's a switched on bloke, and he's a Blues fan. He loves the club. You know, how many times have you seen him... pictures on the car park at St Andrews, coming out to just spend his time talking to Blues fans. He's going to do everything in his power to do the right thing. With all of his contacts in football, do you really think the next manager, if they get rid of Eustace, is going to be someone like Rooney? I just don't see it. Brady might want it, you know, because it's his mate and he sees him as a name. I can't see Cook swallowing that.
On you, Dave, Harry Kane's his mate as well, isn't he?
We did enough with Zola, so we don't need another name. We need
I did post up when we knew it was all happening. I posted up the Mbappe one in the blue shirt. So at first,
I'm getting cold with this one. I must admit, if it happened, I think. Well, who knows? We don't know. I mean,
we don't. All we know is the future's brighter than it was.
Definitely. I think on the managerial front, you know, more of a worry than John Eustace at the moment is the poor form of the ladies, since, you know, we've invested so much money and three games in, only 1 point, and what
only one goal.
One goal. Your video will be going up later on today, and I know Stephen Gale, your write up will go up as well, and they're both completely honest the way things are. It begs the question, have we invested too much in a very short space of time, and has it upset a little bit of the balance in the team? We need to get off mark. You know, the plain and simple thing is, we go another game or two games into this, if we haven't got the 3 points and started climbing the table, we're going to be nowhere near a promotion team. And to see Crystal Palace, for example, who beat us the week before, but going out and spanking Durham by 9-1 the weekend shows that other teams mean business. But on the opposite side of that, we also need to back this team. You know, Sunday, we've got a game against Charlton at St Andrews. You know, let's get as many people down there as possible to support it. I mean, we've got, 11,000, 11,500, maybe even 12,000 season ticket holders for the men's team. Every single person gets a free ticket to go and see the ladies. So why can't we get that sort of attendance and support down at St Andrews? I agree, not everybody's kettle of fish, but guess what? Get your ticket. Give it to somebody else. Give it to somebody that wants to go. It's get people down there, support, backing them.
That Craig, is a difficult one. You can't advocate that, really, can you?
What?
Giving a ticket to somebody else.
You can. Yeah. You know, it's a...
Yeah,
it's,
I'd rather it be full than not use a ticket. I mean, I'm going to do it with mine. I'm going to give it to people who I know who would be... who would never go to a football match. I'd rather give them a ticket than it go for not being used at all.
And I know that there's only the one stand open, but it doesn't matter. Let's still fill it. Let's give them an excuse to open up other areas of the grounds. You know, let's get down there and back Darren Carter and the ladies. Let's get these first 3 points over the line at the weekend and look to take things forwards, because it is a bit of a rut. But at the end of last season, it was the total opposite, where we couldn't lose a game. And, you know, we beat ultimately the champions. We beat the teams that were in and around us at that point in time. So we know they're capable of doing it. Yeah. We got the Barclays player of the season in Jade Pennock in our team. You know, not even the team that got promoted when they had their players named in that run. So we've got that. And now we need to get behind them and show them some support and back them as much as we possibly can. Claire, somebody's put the light on, turn it off.
I'm sure they can turn it round with Hope Powell there, and obviously Darren Carter's a top bloke, isn't he? So I'm sure they can turn it round. I'm sure they can.
I watched the game yesterday, and the end of last season I went to the same venue and we beat Lewis 4-0. Jay Pennant got a couple of cracking goals, and I went to see him play Crystal Palace. They won that 4-2 again away. And what I saw yesterday was totally unbelievable. Who are these people? Jay Pennock, she's wonderful last year. Goals, 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 goals. She never looked like she was at the races. There was this, I would say she's probably 18, young black girl who wore glasses, right, and couldn't head the ball. And she just denied Birmingham's forward line any sight of goal. She was wonderful, and I'm thinking, what's happened to this team that I saw? It's only 4 months ago. 4 months ago, when I saw this, and I'm saying, well, if we don't win the league this year, we'll piss it next year, and they ain't gonna. They don't look like they're gonna score a goal. It's really, really, and I don't know. Somebody tell me. How can a team? I know we've had new faces, but that's supposed to improve us. Yeah. It hasn't. What's happened?
Too much, though, can't it? I mean, we've experienced it in the men's. When we look about the amount of income that happened back in the Redknapp day, and we was like, oh great, we're bringing in all these fantastic players, and they're all going to better us. But actually, some of them made us worse.
Same. And we paid a massively heavy price for it as well, Craig.
And I think, but the thing is, these players at the club at the moment, and these ladies are capable. You know, they haven't come from teams that have just scraped their way through stuff. They've come from teams that have been in the Women's Super League. You know, they have been released. They've come to our club. They want to see us go forwards. And I'm sure that we can do something, and we can get the momentum that we need. But in turn, that still requires our support, you know, and I'll try my utmost to be there as many games as I can. The little one wants to go more and more, you know. The women's game's on the up, so we need to be there to support it as well. And
that's the problem, though, isn't it? Everyone's trying to get a slice of the women's game. You know, Blues are one of the top, you know, outside of the big two or three, we're the only side to sort of challenge them for 10 years. Unfortunately, we've got caught cold just as it's getting really popular. You know, if we don't get, I'm a massive Moseley fan. Talked rugby earlier, I used to go to Moseley when I was a young kid. Moseley used to win quite regular trophies and leagues, but then got caught in financial trouble just before professionalism kicked in rugby. They've never recovered. You know, they're in the doldrums, and you don't want that to happen to. I don't think it will with the Blues ladies, because you know there's too much being invested in it. But everybody's doing it. You know, there's a lot of catching up to be done, and other teams are. I mean, look at them lot down the road. I mean, they've been nowhere for years with women's football, and all of a sudden they've come from nowhere, and they're up there, and you know, the pinched half our side and the manager and that. And
The only thing though, we need a revamp of the women's game. We just won up. It's just not. It don't seem fair, does it?
I mean, the championship, Super League, it's ridiculous. I mean, they want to grow the numbers. But there seems to be a fear over growing the numbers of teams that sit in the Women's Super League, and it makes no sense whatsoever. Go back to like we are, you know, two teams automatically promoted. Why can't they have a playoff and bring some of the, you know, if the leagues that are below given a chance, maybe merge them together and make one bigger league so that there's more competition, more teams then to be relegated.
It's all to do with money. So I know a lot of players that play like below the championship level, and you know, like I know players who have played for West Brom, Wolves, Forest, and things, and people like that. And it's all to do with the money. It's the travel. It's the fact that they're not like professionals. They, you know, they work all week and then they play a game on a Sunday. Mm. And everything. If you, the women as well, is obviously if you're in an academy for a boys' football team. So say if you're Blues, you will start the academy. You could end up finishing the academy, then going up to, you know, the Blues first team. So you're used to playing football every single day. You know, you go to school, you play. Women's football is totally different. This is one of the reasons why we're getting all the ACL injuries and everything else, because they haven't got the academy structure. And, you know, like Leah Williamson was like, I used to play, I have to play once a week, and I trained once a week, and she's now England captain. That's why, that's the problem. We're so far behind that the grassroots need to catch up with the boys' grassroots. And then that's when it will then accelerate. You know, you've got the Man Cities who have got loads of money. I mean, unfortunately, those down the road, you know, they got Rachel Daly, Jordan Nobbs, and all these England internationals as well. And you've got Arsenal who can just get players and everything else. They're leagues ahead. We've been behind for ages, and that's the problem, because you know, the owners took the money from the women's team. At one point, we didn't even know we were going to have a women's team.
No.
So, Claire, a quick question for you, Claire, right? Mm-hmm. If you were a ladies footballer, would you sign for Birmingham City or would you sign for Arsenal?
Arsenal.
Take the Blues element out of it. Yeah, and that's the thing, isn't it? Mm.
I just think that, like, obviously, you know, I played football for years anyway, and it's just the tiers and everything. Like, it's just so, you know, to get all sponsorship, to get everything is so much more difficult in the women's game. Everything from grassroots upwards. But obviously, hopefully that will start changing. You know, we're already so many years behind because we were banned from playing football as well, so... Hopefully the Blues ladies, hopefully she will be back as well. So I think we miss her in defence as well, and just hopefully we can, you know.
Question from me, okay. Next week we've got a game on. Sorry, I'm talking about Blues men now. So Saturday we've got Watford away.
Yeah.
Tuesday we've got Preston away.
Mm.
And then that Friday, literally 3 days later, we've got QPR at home. We've got the squad to cope with that.
Yeah.
No. I think we have now.
Is that all fit, yeah.
Do you think that is quite close together, isn't it? Tuesday and then Friday after, like, so you got what?
Have you seen Christmas?
Well, the championship is
four games in 12 days.
Yeah, four games. I saw that.
Three days.
That's crazy.
You've got three games in 6 days, though. It's not normally that bad, is it? Three games in 6 days.
Isn't the Friday night one on TV?
Yeah.
Well, you know. Sky says jump, and we say how high. You know,
I think also.
Yes, it's right.
Checkbooks, isn't it? Checkbooks.
Yeah.
It's not just that, though. I mean, I can tell you straight off that one of the other reasons is we've just played a game against the bunch of nutters that are Millwall, where there was trouble outside the stadium and in the centre of Birmingham. Millwall absolutely hate and detest QPR. QPR are playing Birmingham. Millwall are playing West Brom.
Yeah.
So part of the movements on the Friday evening is also through the police. And that is the right thing to do because, you know, do we want to be known just on a Saturday afternoon that we've had a 3 o'clock kickoff and all it is actually is an excuse for the fans to get together and have a punch up afterwards?
Craig, no. Do we want to show this and that kind of attitude to our new owners? No.
It's not, but I've said it before, not fans.
That's an interesting point, Craig, because living here, when I do, Millwall is one of my local games. I can get to Millwall in an hour. So I have, from here, I've lived here for 10 years now, and I've been to the away game at Millwall every time midweek, because midweek there's a few tickets available. On a Saturday, I can't get there, right? And we've also played Millwall at home in midweek, and there's been no trouble. In the last 2 years, suddenly they say, oh, let's have Millwall turning up to St Andrews on a Saturday. And both times there's been trouble. Now, why do they think, you know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it? Millwall have turned up 8 years, 8 seasons on the trot at St Andrews in midweek and probably won five of them.
In
front of a very low crowd normally as well. Why did they suddenly let the reins off and think nothing would change? I mean, it's ridiculous.
It's like an invitation, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Part of it's also, though, you know, and the guys from Westminster Police, you know, when they've been on the show before, have explained that the games go through their categories. So there's a game that there's a risk of trouble. So they'll try and swap it. Well, if they then go a few seasons where there's no trouble between it, it's downgraded. So, yes, you're right. There have been a few games where Millwall have been down and there's been no hassles. Normally those midweek games, you know, as they've come up in the fixtures, because it doesn't give the excuse to go out and get absolutely twisted beforehand. But link with QPR is the reason for that Friday game as well. And yeah, I can't knock it. It would have been also West Brom changing it, and I think it's a lot
easier. I mean, would you, Craig, seriously want Birmingham City fans, Millwall fans, Queen's Park Rangers fans, and West Bromwich Albion fans in the city centre at the same time? The answer is simply a two-letter word: no.
Well, they would all, if the games were played simultaneously, all the fans, the London fans, would all come up on that Euston train at the same time. And they,
on the same route.
You'll be lucky to get the bloody thing into New Street in one piece. Yeah. I mean, I've travelled there quite a bit, and you do get mixtures of fans, you know. You'll get people going to Coventry from London, people going to the Albion from London, obviously coming to us from London. And I sit there and look around and keep my gob shut and you know, they're all drunk out of the minds before they get on the train, you know, at 10 o'clock or whatever it is. You know, and I can understand that. I can understand that. But I can't understand why we played Millwall two seasons in a row at home on a Saturday. Can't understand that because it was working before.
The problem is also it does affect, like, for example, I have disabled people behind me and I know that they cannot make night games. So it does affect more and more than just, you know, it does affect everybody. So, like, they'll say, oh, you know, like, we haven't got a home game. So is it the 4th of November?
November.
Yeah.
So
those people are going to miss out. I mean, the next few away games we've got coming up are Sunderland, Norwich, Southampton and Middlesbrough. I mean, they're
missions, aren't they?
You know, it's thinking about those that can't make it because it's moved to a Friday, but it's understandable why. But at the same time, you know, we've got some more on a Friday as well, haven't we? We've got
the Albion as well, isn't it?
So,
well, I'll tip my hat anyway to any fan that's going to be at all three of them games next week. you know, because you got Watford away, Preston away, and then obviously QPR on the Friday. Obviously QPR's not a problem, but Watford
all the way. I can tell you now, Paul, categorically, I can't make all three, I promise you.
I'm not going to Preston, but I'm going to Watford.
Yeah. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, talk show on Monday night. Here we go. We're into the last 15 minutes. So I'm going to come to the last 15 minutes in exactly 2 minutes' time. I want you to quickly discuss the World Cup final kiss.
Totally outrageous and wrong. And I'm glad you didn't mind.
Do you know what? When we won the... Oh, Claire. Oh.
It's wrong. I'm sorry.
He had got her arms round him.
And I'm glad he has resigned. That is all I'm going to say.
If that happened in the street, be arrested for sexual assault.
Be arrested.
Oh, for God's sake, what a poxy country we're now
He's done the right thing. He's gone, but he should have gone a lot earlier to stop all the hassles. Sorry to say it, but end of conversation. But here we go. I have got higher or lower.
Go on, then. Hey, I'm not being funny, but I'm just going to give this quickly, very, very quickly, right? If I was sat or stood next to you and we just won the cup final, I'll put my tongue down your throat, mate. I promise you.
Well, don't do it to any woman, no. You do it to whoever you want. But don't. But ask them for consent, and then they'll probably say no.
Yeah.
Controversial. I love it.
Higher or lower.
I love it.
Higher or lower. These are mixtures over the years. So, Dave, I don't know if you've heard over the past couple of weeks what we've been doing, but in short, got a list of players, and it's based on goals scored in the league as per... our friend Wikipedia, which we do know can be adapted because we've seen some rather funny comments. But this is based on the goals. So we say, are they higher or lower in terms of the goals?
Yeah.
So we'll start off with Paul Furlong. He's the first player. And my question is, did Bob Hatton score more or less than Paul Furlong? Oh,
it's a good question.
Gotta be more.
Wow. That's a tough one, isn't it?
My first zero going the Blues, Bobby Hutton.
I'm gonna go more for me. I'm gonna go more for Bob Hutton.
Yeah, yeah. A few people go
for me. The answer is it is more. Good. Bob Hutton scored 58 goals during his time at the Blues, whilst Paul Furlong was a nice round 50. But one interesting fact though is Paul Furlong still has the best goals to games ratio in the club for the past 35 years.
Really? I think it is
now. So,
yeah,
brilliant.
But he did score the right
end of the 75,
didn't
he? So, the next player is Simon Sturridge.
Ooh.
He didn't score that many.
Not on the betting side.
Versus who?
I reckon lower.
He's got to be lower.
Gotta be, yeah, lower for me.
Yeah, I reckon he only scored about 30 goals for Blues.
Yeah, he chipped in 7 or 8. So
26, I say.
Mr. Meredith.
Talking about, because I missed it.
Simon Sturridge.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Meredith, good knowledge. He actually did score 30 goals for the club.
Well done.
Yes, Mark.
Good guess, Mark.
My boy.
The next one is Steve Claridge. More or less than 35.
More.
I think he got more than 35.
He got 20 in one season, didn't he?
He got 25. Yeah. Most of the season, he got about 27.
What a the savant, too.
I think it's a trick question.
More.
Yeah. I don't know, you know, because the season after we got promoted, he was there then, wasn't he, in the championship?
Yeah, he didn't score that many, though.
Yeah. He was only there for a bit, and then he went to Leicester.
He
was only with us, literally, for like a bit of the one season when we went down. And then he was in League One then, wasn't he, under where he got over 20 goals, like Alan said. But I think that's lower.
Yeah, I think that's lower as well, I think.
Lower than 30 or what?
Lower than 30 is what we're saying. So actually he scored 35 goals for Birmingham during that stint.
Did he? One against us at St Andrews.
I was at Leicester when he scored against us in the Cup. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
On
the 4-2?
Yeah.
Eskie scored as well that day, didn't he?
Did.
And Tony Cotty did. There was three players who scored against us there that played for us.
Next one on the list is Phil Summerall, friend of the show. More or less?
Scored a few goals.
I'd say Phil was in the side He's a fair number of seasons.
He was, yeah.
Mm.
He was.
So I'd say higher.
I'm going to
say higher as well. I think it's about, I'm going to say 50-ish.
I think he was top scorer for a couple of seasons.
44.
He was top scorer at the club before Francis. There you go. There you go. Just to give you a hint.
How many did he get? Oh, you're not telling me.
He was higher, and he actually got 46 goals.
Ooh, what's on the
club.
No
way.
46 goals.
Is that it, Craig?
That's incredible.
No, one more.
One more.
Djukovic, higher or lower than 46?
Higher.
Higher.
Oh, 50.
Yeah, yeah, scored.
It's got to be higher.
Lower.
Higher.
So, out of all the players that I've actually mentioned, Djukovic is the highest scorer and still going, obviously, with 62 goals.
62? Wow.
Across his two terms at St Andrews.
Okay, for the last 10 minutes we go now, ladies and gentlemen. Anything to do with football and film titles? I'll start off with Charlie George and the Chocolate Factory.
That's probably going to be your best effort.
I'll go with Troy Story.
Have you been practicing this or not?
No.
No, I don't know what you're talking about, Nick.
All day. That's all I've had. All day.
This is why I don't join you. Because I like it fresh, and I like it to be inspirational. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I reckon Unlove Actually as well was my best one.
Unlove Actually.
Oh, that was very good.
What about Frayne, man?
Yeah, I'll chip in with Greyfriars Bobby Charlton.
Or Tate Mile. Tate Mile.
As in 8 Mile.
We heard it the first time, which wasn't very good.
What about the Breen Mile? The Breen Mile is another one, instead of the Green Mile.
What about Lauren Vardy?
The Green Off Mile.
Braveheart
of Midlothian.
What was that, Al?
Braveheart of Midlothian.
I think mine's the best. Knott's Forest Gump.
Yeah. Lawrence of Arabia.
Bridge over the River Fry.
Oh, give up.
let's let the viewers have a go now, shall we? Go
on. We've got some good ones with Mad Max Colin.
I like that one.
Good one.
Mark Brooks has said Billy Wade Elliott. He's absolutely superb. And let's also not forget, we've got the good, the bad, and the violas.
Yeah. Good one.
I think Steve Jobs mentioned earlier, we talked about the improvements obviously carrying on now with the stadium, and we did at the very start of the show, but it's been put back 4 weeks because of the delay, hasn't it? So will it be sort of January when it's fully open again?
Yeah.
I think November, actually, is what they've gone
for. You know what, Paul? I don't think it matters. I think the most important thing is the work is back underway.
Yeah,
yeah, but obviously it's going to be delayed, though, isn't it, because of the delay? So I think it was due to open in November, did you say, Craig, was it? So it's going to be December then, yeah?
No, well, the announcement they've made is that originally it was the end of September for the Tilton. And then they were looking at October, beginning of November, for the COP to join. The announcement that came out from the club hasn't actually given specific dates, but has mentioned that they are looking to finish all work in November. So I think they're targeting for the whole lot to be done, which it makes sense because, you know, we want to be able to sell half year season tickets into those areas.
Yeah, of course we do, yeah. And credit to Birmingham City for giving us this information. This is what we want. Mm. All we ask from our football club is to keep
Who's the company, Craig?
Mace.
They're the company that actually builds New Street.
They're from Birmingham as well.
They are. And
what
I think
was that, Claire? What was that?
They're from Birmingham. I knew someone who used to work for them. They're a good company.
Oh, they're Brum-based?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a Buckingham group.
I think it's fair to say that the group, possibly, and dare we say this, we know about it as a topic of conversation, but they're putting themselves in the window, I think, for an opportunity to potentially build us a new stadium. If they get the work done, they do it to the time frames, then if ever we move, which, again, rumour.
When we move.
Do you know what, Craig?
We haven't been moving very far, but it will happen.
Yeah, well, of course it will, yeah.
I've been going to Blue since 1973, right? Which is actually 50 years next year.
No, it's not 50 years this year.
No, 50 years this year, December. I've been going, And I've seen the old cop, the old Tilton, the main stand, the railway stand, and I've seen the improvements that have been made. And I've seen it degenerate into like a disgraceful show that was, and I'm seeing a rebuilding. And if see a new stadium, if I live to see a new stadium, I would love to be one of the first people through the door.
So some of the fans' names and films are coming through at the moment. So, I was just waiting for this, but the Tom Brady bunch, it had to appear at some point. Yeah.
Oh,
Ray Hobro has said Raging Steve Bull.
That's good.
Trevor Malloy has gone with Tommy Knockers. Say again.
What did you say? Tommy what?
Tommy Knocker.
Instead of Tommy Doherty.
Okay.
Then we've got Ray Hobro again with Citizen Harry Kane.
Yeah.
Nigel Mann, Lee Carry On Camping.
Oh, I like it. Anything to do with Lee Camp on this part of the show, he's always welcomed.
Nigel Mann has gone with Hotter and the Chocolate Factory.
I was just waiting for a Hotter. My head's been spinning, I promise you.
About the last 4 minutes thinking about a
Hotter. Just while they're still coming in for the last sort of minute or so, Mark Meredith, best goal you've seen live at St Andrews?
Right now.
You've got to go back.
Yeah, I think probably Francis against Leeds in the semi-final.
That was a cracker, wasn't it?
Especially just the height of him as well, and seeing him smack that one from
All I can see with that goal is earrings and a massive chain around his neck. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Not at St Andrews, but what about that goal we scored at Liverpool?
Oh, Jerome.
I was behind that one when that happened.
You know what? Even Ricky Otto's at Liverpool was just as Ricky good, actually.
Yeah. And you will never, ever, ever, ever beat Johnny Gale's overhead kick at Wembley.
Deb Larson at Tottenham was a good one as well, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Deb Larson at home against Sheffield Wednesday.
Brent Worthington's two against Forest.
Yeah.
Held them both in from the left hand corner of the box.
Yeah.
Received the ball with his back to goal.
Yeah.
Shimmy turned and killed it into the far corner against Shilton twice.
Brilliant.
Come and say goodbye to everybody. Bye bye.
You remember Julia the Beck?
Yeah, Mark, John Sorrell against the Ipswich. That was on my birthday, that was.
Yeah.
I've never mentioned my birthday.
Any more films, people?
Christmas Games Hill,
Blues Magnificent 7.
Oh, I love it.
We've got Delia the Bug's Life. we've also got apparently for the old owners, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
I'm looking for more.
Great film.
Dealey Does Dallas.
That's for Mark.
It's close. It's close, that is.
Lilypad, 50 Shades of Julian Grey.
There's a good one here. There's a really good one here. Three men and a little Brady.
We've all missed the moment, haven't we?
Go on.
Zulu.
Zulu, of course.
Zulu, yeah.
Oh, we've had all day to think of that one and we didn't come up with that.
Most obvious one.
Ray Hobro, Some Like It Hotter.
Yours earlier, Craig Clark. Or my mum will shoot.
Yeah, Clough or my mum will shoot.
License to Gill.
Yeah, good.
Yeah. Star Wars The Force Awakens.
I'm going for Mary Hopkins.
Force Awakens, yeah. Like
Mary Hopkins.
That's not bad, is it?
Delia
the Black.
Quantum of Salah.
Quantum of Salah.
But only Claire, you must have been thinking of them in your lesson.
Right, children. What I want you to do today is think about films and football people, so I can write them all down.
Yeah, forget what on your agenda. You've just got to do this in your lesson.
Yeah.
I wish.
Of course, we've got to put in there. Look who's Tilton talking.
Oh, yeah. Very good.
Who's that one from? Because I'll tell you what, that's right up there.
Is it wicked? That's mine.
That's Greg's.
I'll tell you what, that was awful.
If you said it was awful, I was going to say it was Mark's.
Hey, hang on.
I've been waiting for a Wayne Rooney one, but yeah. Wayne Rooney, sure. Graham?
Who's a winner? Have we got a favourite?
It's got to be Zulu.
Yeah, it's
Toad, Toad of Toad Spore.
Saving Pride.
You can tell it comes from Coventry, can't you?
Yeah. I'm not from Coventry.
The Devlin Wears Prada.
Yeah.
Indiana Phil Jones.
I did this one last time we had this subject. Godfather 2, Rocky 3.
Yeah. Yeah, like, oh, for God's sake. Oh, my God. What a brilliant.
Do you think next week we should do TV?
Yeah.
I'll give the last 15 away. Think about it.
Yeah, you give it, as I say, you just killed it now, Mark.
Can I get away with Aladdingles?
What he said to me?
Mine was funny, Mark.
There you go. Nicholas, it's time to go.
You're all mad, a lot of you. It's time to go. This has been the Tilton Talk Show. Monday, wow, the 11th of September, 2023. As we've remembered tonight, those that were lost and affected by the 9/11 atrocities, and we've also spoken at great length, and David, what a great conversationist you are on the subject, my friend, on the Justice for the 21. The work on St Andrews has rescheduled. It started. We're cracking on. They're getting on with it. And you know what? We're going to love you and leave you until next week. Watford next Saturday, isn't it?
This Saturday, yeah.
Watford away next Saturday, 3 o'clock kickoff. Be safe, Birmingham City fans. Yeah? Be safe. From Paul Hipkiss.
One flew over the cuckoo's nest, over Mars attacks. Good night, all.
Over Mars attacks. Yes, that's good.
He don't stop, does he? Great, Courtney.
You know, everybody, and just a couple from the shape box. We've got Wayne Clark's World. We've already mentioned some like your Hotter, but for me, Alice in Wagnerland, that's just absolutely brilliant. That's good. That is superb. And that's from Lilypad.
Right, name and shame, because that's the winner tonight.
That's Lilypad, and that's and Dave, just so you're aware, Lily writes us some really good poetry and has said that she is actually going to write one based on the Justice for 21. So I'll send it over to you.
Brilliant, thank you.
Okay, Watto, Chairman of the Board.
Good night, everybody. God bless you all.
And yourself, my friend. Dave Taylor.
Yeah, thanks for this time again. Much appreciated. And as always, keep right on.
Dave, you know what? Then first 7 minutes, mate, I'm going to watch and watch and watch that over and over again. I promise you. Chris Brown.
Good night. Thanks for listening. And Diggly had a bowl of popcorn watching the film.
Leg Evelyn.
Good night. See you at Watford, whoever's going.
Where's your mum tonight?
She's sat over there.
Turn around. Let's have a look. Let's have a look at the Mrs. Giblin.
Come on, no. Bab. Come on, Bab.
She's going, no, don't do it.
Yeah, I'll see you at Watford.
Yeah, I'll see you at Watford.
Mark Adams, have I forgotten you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah,
don't worry about it. I've got a
drink. Awfully acceptable.
Mark,
Can I speak, please? Have a lovely week, everyone. Take care.
Who listened to you, Mr. Forceful?
Oh, I love you, mad people. You're all absolutely wonderful. God bless you. Have I forgotten anybody?
Mr. Meredith.
Meredith in America.
Meredith in America. Of course, you know what? Tonight we've talked about 9/11. 22 years ago, that is just insane.
Crazy.
Absolutely insane, Mark. Let's just hope that things like this never happen again. Never. Because awful. Anyway, for myself, the Tilton Talk team, which has been an absolute blast tonight, a little bit different show. We don't care because, like, so we spoke about other things, and it's great to do that. For every single person that's tuned in, listened, or watched, thank you. God bless you. Take care, and we'll see you back here. And
let's say goodbye, Mark in America.
We, Kyle.
Thank you.
You're not crazy.
Bye, Mark.
Thank you.
Good night, Billy Bob.
Good night, John Boy.
Good night, Mama.
And all the bitches in the street.
Good night, Bob.
Good night, Sharon.
Just enough. Come on,
Brandon. You'd laugh at that one. Brilliant.